let's go over our materials real quick for the build of these tanks. Our electrical, we're going to need some 12-3 wire, which is wire that has four leads in it. So you have two hots, a ground, and a neutral. We're going to need some 12-2 service cable. So instead of having four, this only has three. This is about 6 feet. Now this is 12 feet of the cable. We're going to need a 20 amp receptacle. We're going to need a 20 amp switch. You're going to need a face cover like this. So you have one for a switch and one for a plug. Then you're going to need a 4-inch junction box. You're going to need some plugs, and I got these 20 amp plugs so they can't be confused or plugged into a socket, because these are going to be what's used to plug in the water heaters. You're going to need two stainless steel water heaters, and these are 1500 watt, 120 volt. That works out to about 9 amps, and to keep it at the 20 amp, that's plenty that we need to keep it on the 20 amp circuit. You're going to need a new work box from Lowe's or Home Depot. Is a plastic 2-gang box. You're going to need some type of heavy duty 20 or 30 amp plug that can accept two poles of electricity, a neutral and a ground, which some of those we won't be using. I would recommend getting a cover for it and a plug that it'll plug into. And we're also going to need some spade terminals to hook the wires into the water heaters. What's going to make up the tanks? Well, we're going to use PVC to make up the tanks. So we have 3-inch PVC in the back of the car, right there. So what we have here is we have some adapters, and we're going from 3-inch down to 2-inch, from 2-inch to 1.5-inch, and then we're going from 1.5-inch to 1-inch threads, which accommodate the heaters. So just a standard pipe thread on the water heater elements. We want to figure how deep we want these tanks to be. Now these are just heated solution tanks, only going to be used for cleaning guns or parkerizing them. Parkerizing only requires about 170 degrees Fahrenheit, whereas degreasing or boiling off parts is going to need about 212 degrees Fahrenheit. So relatively low temperatures when we compare those to what it takes to do black oxide or bluing. The longest action I have ever had to work on or refinish was about 38 inches long with the barrel action and muzzle brake all together. So what I want to do is I want to make sure that I can handle the longest action I have, but do two things. One, I want to account for a little bit of headspace so I have room to set the action and it does get good coverage over the fluid that's in there. And two, I want to account for a little bit of thermodynamics in how much expansion is going to occur from the tanks being heated. I don't want to get them to heat and then have the fluid run out of the tanks all over the electricity. So what we want to do is we want to get these primed and seated first, then seat this heater and see how much this is going to protrude out, because we do not want our part to touch this heater while it's on. First, start by priming the PVC or cleaning it with the purple cleaner. Now, one thing I think it's fair to mention, for these tanks, because they're going to be subjected to pretty intense amounts of heat that's not really normal for a residential application, I'm using heavy-duty PVC cement. There's no endorsement for Odie, it's just all that's available. Why I mentioned we want to pull our measurements based on the assembled end caps is because the heater is going to protrude up out of here more than it would when these were not assembled. So what I want to do is I want to pull from where the PVC pipe is going to stop, which is going to be this, where this chamfer is right here, where it steps down, there's a line, and that's where the PVC pipe is going to bottom out. And according to that, I'm at about 2.25 inches. So I want to account for expansion. I want to also account for almost a 39-inch action. And with that 2.5 inches, I don't want the action or any parts, long parts that I put in here to touch this heater element while it's on. So if I said 39, 40, 41,
and add that 2.5 inches, that'll be 41.5. I'm gonna just call it 3 just to stay safe. So that'll put us up to 42 inches. I need to allow about 1.5 to 3 inches for expansion, so that puts us at 45. And so it's probably best to cut the tank somewhere between 45 and 48. Alright, so now we're going to install the heaters in the tanks. There's not a lot of threads on these, so I want to get a good seal, because with electricity and water, we really don't want these leaking. A good healthy amount of Teflon tape is probably more than necessary for this application. Now, I want to actually leak check these. So I'm gonna grab the hose, fill them up, and check for any leaks. So now that we got these cut, what I wanna do is go ahead and build and construct a frame for them. Basically, the frame is gonna allow these to sit separated up against the bench, hold them in place properly, and allow us to not have to worry about these tanks tipping over on us when it comes time to put parts in. You'll just rack the parts down, call her good. Just making the basis for a frame right now. Don't really know how it's gonna come out, so this is just kind of all running around in my head at the moment. So now I'm gonna measure across the diameter of the two pipes, because now I want to figure out how wide they are so I can mount up some bracings. So I got 8.5 inches across. So I want to surround these in boxes so they hold them straight. This side would mount to your bench, wall, or whatever you wanted to mount it to. Boom, and it holds your tanks. Since we're doing electricity, in the event, let's just say these tanks were able to fail, having the tanks sitting straight on the ground with water running out of them is gonna be, well, an electrical problem. So what I wanna do is I wanna raise them up off of here. So there's a little bit of a gap, so that way if water does run, it's gonna be drops of water. It'll give me enough time to unplug it from the wall safely. So by raising this up off of here, it's just more or less a safety measure. Inside of your electrical panel is first accessed by removing the 4 screws on the door where all your circuit breakers are. So we're gonna have a little discussion about electricity. And if you're not comfortable doing this, then I encourage you to stop and call an electrician to help you out with your needs. This is very simple, but for some people, they're not very comfortable. For others, they are comfortable doing it. So I'm gonna show you some things. You see my little laser pointer right here. If I would have wired this, it would not look like this. Where that laser is, that is a hot wire coming in from your meter. This also is a hot wire coming in for your meter. Each one of these wires feeds 120 volts of electricity at 200 amps up these bus bars. which you won't really see, but these connect onto a little bar, and the circuit breakers plug onto those bars. This is your neutral return. This over here, little bus bar over here, is going to be a ground. And I don't know if you can see that, but it's right there. That's where your grounds tie in. You're going to need a circuit breaker if you don't already have it. Now, because these heaters are 120 volts, I'm going to be using these two empty circuit breakers right here. They are not in use, and they're 20 amps, so that way I don't have to buy any. The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to run some wire. I'm going to drop it out of the bottom of the box. There should be some knockouts down here. See these little round things that are knockouts? So we'll knock one of those out, run the wire through. So once you drilled your routing holes, now would be the time to go ahead and begin running your wire. So once you have gotten pretty much everything put in to the walls and all the wires run, we can start stripping off the ends of the Romex, the yellow parts, which just leaves us the wires. You're gonna have a series of wires and stuff in here. Obviously the grounds we wanna hook up, and we can use these bus bars on either side to hook those up. So as you can see, I went through and I actually re-cleaned up this box because I couldn't work in here. This thing was a disaster, a fire hazard waiting to happen. So, but we can just start routing our wires. We need these to be on 20 amp circuits. So like this black one right here, I try to keep everything at 90 degree angles. It makes it cleaner, look nicer. In case another electrician comes in here, you're gonna make his life real easy, trust me. What we did is we've inset the wires into wire holders so they're not rubbing on bare metal. And we've wired everything up. So we have our plug wires right here. We have our neutrals wired in over here. We have our grounds wired in over here. And then we also have one right here. We run down through the wall, down under here, and come up into this box. Usually within 6 inches of a box, you're going to want to have a wire staple that holds the wire to the wall, but shit, half the stuff in this place isn't even code. And then on your plugs, the gold side is going to need the black wire or the red wire. The white side wants the silver screw, and then the green screw wants the copper wire. And that is how you properly wire up a plug. Then, of course, this one, since I don't have my phone stand, this one I'm going to have to just wire in off camera, but it's pretty simple. You just need to clip the wire. You know, your neutral is always your neutral. Your red is always your hot. Your black is always your hot. And your ground is always your ground. So now we have a pretty accessible framework. I couldn't find a four-gang face cover that would cover this setup, so we just kind of had to make our own, but it works. We got plugs down here, and now my beer fridge won't have to be stretched all the way up to the wall right here, and washer plugs in nice and flat. And then plus we got two plugs for extension cords, and we got this plug right here, which will be our tank extension cords. You could also run probably a really small 110 welder on it, but cleaning up the panel really makes a big difference. To me it does, because I just can't work when there's a mess of wires just flowing down. So it turned out nice. It really did. You know, some people would say, well, why would you do that to a rent house? You know, hey, you're making something better for the guy that gives you a place to live. And, yeah, I pay him rent every month. But, you know, he can say, hey, I'm done renting my house and I don't have a place to stay. So always try to be good stewards of each other, especially in these times. So now would probably be a better time than any to strip your cables and get the heaters mounted prior to permanently affixing the tanks into the tank mount. So we won't be using the green ground for the heaters, so you can snip that off as well. We'll just be using black and white. Your white will be your neutral return wire, and your black will be your hot wire. So now we just need to hook up our spades. These water heater elements, it doesn't matter which end goes in what, so they're kind of like phase neutral. You can kind of put them wherever you want them to go.
Remember, make sure you get 120 volt ones, because if you get 240s, this ain't gonna work.
And that is what they should look like when they're ready to roll. And next, we're just gonna go ahead and lock these in position and reinstalling this top cap that I pulled off, because I kind of made a mistake. I'm just doing this. This is all in my head right now, so. Now I'm gonna put a screw right here, and I'm gonna show you what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna slowly watch this thing as it goes through. This is gonna help keep these from spinning around on me. Check it out. See where that screw is? Don't run these into your tanks, but I'm gonna slowly let this thing down. Look at that. Still spinning? Okay. Let it go a little more. Now it don't spin. Problem solved. And as you can see, if I try to spin it, it doesn't spin, but it doesn't put a hole in the tank. This is schedule 40 PVC. So it's just a little mar right in the side, and it keeps the tank from spinning around on you, so it stays in place. So go ahead and get your plug set up, because this is the extension cord. These are pretty basic, just follow the directions. You have two poles. Because we only have, even though this is a four pole, we're only using three poles on this, so we're using the neutral, a hot, and a hot. And the only reason I didn't buy a three pole plug is, well, because they didn't have any. Thanks, COVID-1984. Once that's on, we're gonna go ahead and wire our box. So we need to knock this out. That's about probably all we're gonna need. Once you have it in, go ahead and tighten this cord down. Okay, so a little thing with plugs, and a lot of people don't know this, but do you see this little tab right here with the hole in it? Okay, they put these on here because these tabs connect electricity from the top to the bottom, or bottom to top, whatever. So this way you can plug electricity. You can take a hot and a neutral wire and plug it anywhere in the top or bottom of these plugs, and they'll still work. You also have the option to remove these tabs to isolate the top from the bottom, so you can plug one home run here and another home run there, or vice versa. The reason I want to do this is because I'm gonna have a switch in here to turn on and off a certain heater. Now, I might want to heat both of these at the same time. If that's the case, that's fine, because I have this box, which is a digital thermostat temp controller, and this temperature controller will be plugged into this, and the other heater, once it boils the water, I want to shut it off manually, so I will have a switch on my electricity box. The only way to make this work is to isolate these plugs from the top and the bottom. So all you need to do is break this off. You see how it's isolated both of those two from each other. So now we have two 20 amp receptacles that can work individually from each other, and we can switch them. That's my goal. So one's gonna be auto and one's gonna be switched. That's what those are for. If you look on every single receptacle, they have those. So if you ever need to isolate them, and you want to use a different power source for the bottom than the top, you remove this. We have a neutral green wire. Green is normally ground, so it's actually hooked up to the neutral. We have this white wire, which is hooked up to one leg of the 120 volts of electricity on its own circuit. And then we have another 120 wire right here, this black one, that's also hooked up to a separate leg on its own circuit. What we have here is a switch. So this hot comes into this switch. The switch can turn it off or on. Then it comes into the other side of this plug. So here's our white with 120 isolated. The bottom will be 120 volts and the top will be isolated, be 120 volts. We have two separate circuits on one plug. On the backside, what we have, because I remove that, which is about the stupidest thing I could have done. We have our neutral return wire to the panel coming in, and then I created a jumper to jump back down to the bottom because for some reason I just removed that not thinking like an idiot. This is the setup. This is what's going to make our heater setup work. All right, guys, and one thing too, it's probably fair to mention, when you're using these metal boxes, J boxes, you need to break these off. And you just sit there and wiggle them and they come right off. We have everything ready to go. So what we're going to do here, we're going to go ahead and flip this on. Now again, how I said I have one of these switched and one not switched. This is the switch plug up here, and you can indicate it if you want. So I'll go ahead and flip on that switch, which is going to turn power on to the first heater, and then we'll press the power button on this one, which will bring us on, and it shows us our current temperature. Now I already fired these up, but I was able to get this up to boiling temperature in about 15 minutes. I mean, this came up quick. So we're at 202 and we're already starting to boil off. Whoa, hey, you daring. And it'll just hold that temperature. I got it set at 214. You can set it at 212 and it'll cycle. So if you need to do a rapid boil for like 20 minutes, you can do it that way. If not, if you just want it to stay at 212, you can just set it to 212 and there's a differential set, so it'll cut it on and off automatically. The great thing is there's no leaks. You know, this thing is really slim, very slimline, because when I do not need it and I need to store it, I want to be able to store it relatively easily, without it taking up a lot of room. And so that's the design I went for. And I just tied onto the bench, you know, see, in the original video, in the first part of this video, I was saying, oh, we'll use this to screw it on. Yeah, you could, but, you know, it's fine right there. It makes a good armrest. Just some safety concerns to worry about for you out there that might be making one of these. You could go with a 20-amp GFI on one of these boxes. That would probably be a lot safer. The GFI is basically what's called a ground fault interrupter. So in the event that you had a slightest contact with water before you electrocute it would throw. They do make 20-amp GFIs, but they're pretty expensive. So I've just showed you in this video how to make your own homemade bluing or parkerizing tanks. And obviously for parkerizing, you would want to run one of these at about 170, 180 degrees till you start getting a really good bite with the parkerized material. But this will allow you to do barreled actions. And honestly, for smaller parts, I get a cheap stainless steel pot from Walmart and just pour your solution in there and use those stainless pots to do your small parts, whether you're doing a slow rust blue or you're doing a cleaning or you're doing a parkerizing. But these tanks are great. I think all in all, I paid about, I want to say everything, the whole material bill was about $120. You know, and that was going with a little bit more fancier stuff. You can go probably less than that, or you can go more fancier than that. You can go with bigger PVC. Honestly, that's the one thing that I kind of wish I would have did. I wish I would have went with the 4-inch as I was initially planning instead of the 3-inch. But hey, you know what? This works, man. I'm happy with this. And I'm sure some of you out there could probably do something bigger and better. And if you do, I'd love to see it. That's how we grow. We share each other's ideas. So, hey guys, thanks for watching. Gun Psychiatrist signing off. If you found this video helpful or interesting, what have you, please hit the subscribe button below. You know, my channel doesn't have a lot of followers, and I'm cool with that. But the followers that I have, all you guys watch my videos, and that's really what I'm out for and appreciate. So thank you for your valuable time and watching me ramble on and learning some cool stuff, I hope. But thanks for watching, guys. I really appreciate it. And hit that subscribe button. And until next time, God bless America again.